Oh, he's done that.
I think it's a wonderful time when dad can help baptize a daughter. Isn't that amazing? And so I remember when you gave your heart to Christ, and that was the greatest moment in your life. And now you're following Christ in baptism. It's just a picture, really, McKinley. When Christ was baptized and put in a grave, that's what is symbolized you're going to do. When we put you in the water, it's a symbolic meaning that you're going to die to the world, spiritually, not physically. And then one day, and then I'm going to raise you up. Me and your dad's going to raise you up. You're going to be a new creature in Christ Jesus. And as you start your life, you know, to live for Christ, as you grow and be a teenager and a young lady, then one day you're going to die. We all going to die. And you get to go to heaven. Isn't that wonderful? That's a wonderful time. All right? Okay. Stand right back here. Dad, put your hands right here. Okay, put your other one right here. Okay. Dad will be behind you. And I haven't drowned it but one. No, I never have lost one. Okay. In obedience commanded by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon profession, this our sister, I baptize thee in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. See you. Okay. Now, you too, you get to go to heaven, right? Do you ever think about heaven? Can you imagine being up there being sick? Have you ever been sick before? Okay. You know why you don't have to go to school? No school. Just enjoy, rejoice, praise the Lord, and have a wonderful time, right?
Well, it's a wonderful time because I don't have school.
It's a wonderful time because you don't have school. Amen. All right. But anyway, you'll have a lot of fun. We get to praise the Lord. And who knows what we're going to do in heaven. But it's going to be a wonderful time. And you like to sing, don't you? Okay. You sing a lot of prayer. Oh, yeah, you're singing with that heavenly choir. So glad you're saved, ain't you? All right. All right. Put your hands right here, sweet. Mama's going to help you. Put your hand right here. Okay. In obedience command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon the profession of this, our sister, we baptize thee in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Okay, Mom. Come up here, please. That wasn't so bad, was it? Just a little. We're glad to have you all part of our church. Now, as you grow older, you'll learn more about God. You'll learn more about God's works through Sunday school, through the teachers as they teach. And then I want you to always remember the most important thing about read the Bible as you get older. And as you get older, you'll understand it a little bit. Sometimes it's a little difficult to understand as children. But as you get younger, you know, ladies, just read it and pray. Great day, okay?
I know a not so old cousin of mine, Michaela, reads the Bible.
Oh, not so old cousin of yours, Michaela, reads the Bible. Well, that's good. Yeah, that is good. She reads the Bible. And that is wonderful. To read the Bible. It's a wonderful book, right? Wonderful book. And one of these days, you get to meet God. What about that? And you get to meet Jesus who died for us. Wow. He went to the cross. We know that. Hang him on the cross, and that is for us, that we can live in his house. We all live in, we all got all kinds of different places we live. When are they going to live on the same, have the same house number? Heaven. That's the house. We all live together. What a wonderful day that would be. So, we're going to give you a certificate, and
Here is McKinley. There's your certificate. And Miss Angela had to leave before we knew you were going to be baptized. So you're going to get one just like that, okay? But she had to be out of town, so I'm just going to give you this one here, and then we'll give you another one, okay? Next Sunday, we'll give you one just like that. But she was gone, and she didn't have a chance to get your name on it. She'll take care of that next Sunday, okay? All right, let me have prayer with you. Let me have your hand here. Father, we come into your presence. Thank you for these two young girls that are now starting on a journey in Christianity. And I want you to bless them, God, as they travel, as they grow intellectually, physically, and emotionally. May they always remember this time in their life, especially when they gave their heart to you, and especially also when they were baptized. We pray your blessings upon them in Jesus' name. Amen.
She gets two there.
That's yours. Okay. She made a mistake on that. But we'll give you one. Okay.
All right. We'll get it straightened out. God bless you, girls. Okay, whoever's taking over, come on.
Chloe, are we going to the next one? Where did Chloe go? We going to go to the next one? Just a second. Okay. All right. So now I have the twins, McKinley and Michaela. They're going to sing Peace Like a River. Would you both like microphones? Okay.
I got peace like a river in my soul.
I got love like an ocean. I got love like an ocean. I got love like an ocean in my soul. I got love like an ocean. I got love like an ocean. I got love like an ocean in my soul. I got joy like a mountain. I got joy like a mountain. I got joy like a mountain in my soul. I got joy like a mountain. I got joy like a mountain. I got joy like a mountain in my soul. I got peace like a river. I've got love like an ocean. I got joy like a mountain in my soul. I got peace like a river. I've got love like an ocean. I got joy like a mountain in my soul.
Yeah, she knew that mic came off, but that's okay. Everybody heard her, didn't you? Yes, okay. And now Carly is going to come forward, and we practiced a little bit at home and practiced this morning, didn't we, Carly? And I told her, she gets shy, believe it or not, she does get shy up here. And I told her she gives people a blessing by singing to us. And this song, she said, I need a new song. I said, I can hear this song over and over again, and it's called Trust in You, right? And we know we have to trust in God, don't we? Every day. So I'm going to let you sing and give all of us a blessing.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my one never changes what you see. Try to tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. And when all things be my life and bliss, I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. You are my strength.
Now, that was a blessing, wasn't it? Thank you, Carly. And now I'm going to introduce our youth group, our older youth group, and they're going to come to the stage and sing and do sign language for the altar. Right, come on up. Never mind, just one of them come on up.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come.
The service is nearing an end. The choir is singing just as I am. Song is played. People at the altar are kneeling down to pray. Some are finding mercy, forgiveness for their sins. Some are fighting battles and they're struggling to win. The time has come to give them to the Lord. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness, and there's a love that's true. And Jesus is waiting, he is waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. That's what this altar is for. A father is praying with his son. A mother kneels beside them, thanking God they've come. An old man is standing there in tears, giving up a part of him that he's held back for years. Hearts are being broken, lives are being changed. Those who call upon him, they will never be the same. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. Jesus is waiting, he is waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. Those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. Jesus is waiting. He is waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. Your burdens to the Lord. That's what this altar is for.
Make sure that we're worshiping. Well, the Bible tells us we have to worship in spirit and truth. But first off, here in Deuteronomy, we're talking about the greatest commandment. What is the greatest commandment? The greatest commandment, Jesus said, was to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and all thy might. And listen to what Moses says here. And it says, "And these words which I command thee to this day shall be in thy heart." In your heart. There's the issue. People, there's a lot of people today say they love God. They love God. They love God. But do they really love God in their hearts? Is it inside or is it just on the outside? I don't know that. But God knows whether it's here or out there. He knows where it's at. But here, Moses is telling the nation they need to have it in their heart. And it says, "Thou shalt teach that, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children." It's my responsibility as a parent to tell my kids how much I love God and how much I should love God and how important it is for them to love God. It's my responsibility. And I'm afraid today that parents are letting down on that. They're not teaching their children how important it is that they should love God. And how often are we being the examples that we should be? To show the children how we love God. We can tell them we love God, but I'm telling you, they watch you closer than you think. They will know whether you really love God or not. It will show. And that's important for me as a parent, that I have to show my children that I love God. But I have to tell them that, but more importantly, I have to show them. That's one thing I love about Jesus. When he was on this earth, he didn't tell his disciples, you go do this, you go do that, I'm going to sit over here and take it easy. He didn't do that. He walked and he talked and he done everything by actions. He was out there showing them how to live their lives. He was showing them how to be a Christian. He was showing them how to bring the gospel. He showed them everything. He didn't sit back and let them figure it out on their own. No. And that's the same way as parents today. We need to make sure that we tell our children that we love God. And we need to show them that we love God. We look here. It says, when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. The love of God should always be in our hearts, no matter what.
Yeah.
Always. Look at what he says here in verse 8. For laying aside, this is Jesus still speaking, for laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups and many other such things ye do. So this was just one example that God, that Jesus here was using, just one example that their traditions was equal with the Scriptures. This is just one of many. It says here, it says, laying aside, you laid aside the commandment of God, and you're going to hold on to the traditions of men. Wow. Now, and Jesus continues in verse 9. It says, for laying aside, and he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition. Full well knowing you're rejecting the commandment of God to keep your tradition. How often has modern Christianity become to where we reject commandments of God to hold on to our traditions? How often do we catch ourselves not following God's will because of tradition or religion? Now, verse 10. Says for this is Jesus says right here, Jesus is fixing to give them an example. He's going to lay them an example of their traditions against the commandment of God. So he's breaking it down and going to explain to them one way of how they are already ruining the commandments of God. Look here, verse 10. It says, for Moses said, honor thy father and thy mother. And whosoever curseth father or mother, let him die the death. Now, here, again, Jesus is using Old Testament Scripture to quote to them. And he go back and you look at Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Here, Jesus quoted the sixth commandment. And Exodus 20, 12 says, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. That's the sixth commandment. Now, Exodus 21, 17, it says, and he that curseth his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. So we see here that Jesus uses two verses of Scripture from the Old Testament to quote to the Pharisees and the scribes here. And he's going to continue on. Honor. He talks about honoring your father and your mother. To respect, to admire, to support, to meet their needs. You should support and love your mother and your father. God requires it. It's a commandment. There's no way around it. It is what it is. That's what God expects of us as Christians, to honor your father and your mother. Now, Look at what he says in verse 11. Now, he's just quoted two verses out of Exodus to them. But he says, "But ye say." Here he is, but ye say. So the Pharisees say, if a man shall say to his father or mother, it is Corban. That is to say, a gift. By whatsoever thou mightest, that soever mightest be profited by me, he shall be free. And ye suffer him no more to do naught for his father or his mother. So I looked into that, and it is Corban. Corban means devoted to God, an offering. So I want you to think about what was being done here. Think about the Jewish people and what was going on. And Jesus brings this up, so evidently it was an issue, or he wouldn't have mentioned it. But what was happening was, is in these rules and regulations they had around the law, a man could tell his mother and father, when his mother and father asked for help or asked for need, asked for food, they could say, Corban. In other words, everything I have is devoted to God. I can't give you anything because God's more important than you. But the people didn't always follow through with what they were saying. They used this as a way to get out of helping their mother and father. And that was what was happening with these Jewish people. Young people were using this to get out of helping their mother and father. And you see that here, as Jesus says, and ye suffer him no more, and ye allow him no more to do anything for his father or his mother. You let him go. So, in other words, you're just forgetting about the commandment that God laid out for you, the sixth commandment, honor thy father and thy mother. Just simply because they say they're going to give everything they got to God. If you really dig into it a little more, it'll tell you that that was a vow that was made, but if you go into all the Jewish rules that they had, they could get out of it. They didn't have to keep it. It was being abused by the younger Jewish people. Now look at Numbers chapter 30, verse 2. It says, if a man vow a vow unto the Lord, or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth. Look what Ecclesiastes 5:5 says. Better is it that thou shouldest not vow than thou should vow and not pay. Very important. It's better to not make a vow than to make a vow and break it. So here you got young Jewish people not willing to help their mother and father, supposedly making a vow to God, then turn right around and break it. And Jesus, being the man he was and knowing the hearts of men and knowing what was going on, knew that this was being abused and used. Look what he says here in 13. Making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered. And many such things do ye. Making the word of God of none effect through your traditions. So in other words, their traditions and their religion was hindering the gospel. It was hindering what was supposed to be doing, what was supposed to be going on. Look at tradition and religion is what's hindering Christianity today. Yeah. Just like the Pharisees, superficial worship, thoughtless praise, arrogant doctrine, love of error, indifferent prayer, and phony rituals. These things abound in modern Christianity today. And they mark hypocrites. All true worship comes from the heart. All true worship comes from the heart. 1 John 4:19 tells us, we love Him because He first loved us. Look at Matthew 22:36. Listen to what it says. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto the other. Thou shalt love thy neighbor unto thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. All the law and the prophets. These two commandments. These two commandments, according to Jesus, are the greatest that we have. Everything balances off of that. Forget your traditions. Forget your religions. Forget about everything else. And focus on loving God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. And love your neighbor as yourself. This is extremely important today. In modern Christianity, it has become more of rituals, just motions, things that we do. But are we really worshiping God? Do we have the vain worship that these Pharisees had? These Pharisees were worshiping God in the wrong way. It's one thing to worship the wrong God. It's another thing to worship God, the right God, in the wrong way. Extremely important. Extremely important. Now, as Chloe comes and gets the song, as we stand singing just a minute, I want to ask you, how is your life? How is your life with God? It's time for hypocrites and people like these Pharisees to repent. And as for myself, I can't speak for nobody here. I don't know anybody's heart. I only know mine. But I'll be the first to confess to anybody in here that I have been a hypocrite in my time, in my life at one time. We all have, if we're honest. If we're all honest with ourselves, we can all say that at one time in my life, I have been a hypocrite to God. I have. I can tell you times where I just come to church to come to church. I didn't come to do anything else. But see, when you come to church just to come to church, it makes the other church members around you like, well, you know, he's doing good. God knows where you really are. God knows your heart. God knows where you really stand with Him. And so these Pharisees, they, to the people of the nation of Israel, were the best thing you could have to be close to God. But yet, He tells them, hey, your heart is nowhere near me. Your lips honor me, but your heart is nowhere near me. People see, a lot of times, people see the sin in their sins. But they don't see the sin in their traditions and their religion. Now think about that. People see the sin in their sins. But they don't see the sin in their religion and their traditions. Isaiah 1:18 tells us, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. They be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. God is willing to forgive anyone who is willing to repent. That's what I love about God. He is extremely patient. He's extremely loving. And He's always ready with open arms to forgive and take you back into the fold when we mess up. I'll be the first to confess that I've messed up more times than I can count. But He's always willing to take me back. He's always willing. Don't allow vain worship in your life. Always make sure that you're following what God would want. Don't be like these Pharisees and these scribes who had so indoctrinated themselves with traditions and religion that it becomes equal with Scripture. When you study and read, what they were saying had nothing to do with Scripture. God never said that was what you had to do. But yet, it happened. And it's happening today in our churches all over this nation. There's vain worship going on today. Sad to say, but it's true. Empty, meaningless, pointless, lifeless worship. As Chloe gets the song,
if everyone will please stand and turn to page 305. It's going to be the first, second, and last verse.